Good evening. Welcome to this special conversation tonight. I'm Stephen Henry Madoff, the chair of the master's program in curatorial practice at SVA. For anyone interested in the program, there's a table in the lobby with information that will be available at the end of the evening. So very quickly, the format for tonight is that Tania and Shirin will speak for about an hour, after which I'll begin the question and answer session with them and open it to the audience. For those sitting in the back, we will have two people who will have wireless mics, so you just have to raise your hand and they'll come to you. So at a time when sectarian and religious strife and extreme violence are touching all of us, and global forces are at once monolithic and vulnerable, I thought of my two friends, Tania and Shirin, as artists and women of great courage and hope. And it seemed to me that this would be an important moment to bring them together to talk about their experiences and their work. As many of you know, Tania recently underwent interrogations and house arrest in Havana for her art. And she's long been a performance artist, deeply engaged in questions of power and the role of citizens. In fact, as she's said, I try to appropriate the tools and mechanisms of power. I do not want to represent the political, but to create the political. I'm interested in working with citizens, not with audience. Shirin is a global icon for her work in photography, performance, video, and film over the last 25 years, work that addresses the oppression and sorrows of the women of her native Iran, and then widening these expressions. As she says, I believe through art we can go deeper into the universal plight of what it is like to be a human being on this planet today. I tend to consider art as a conduit between people and the people of power. Please welcome Tania Bruguera and Shirin Neshat.
Good evening. I tried to dress appropriately for tonight. Woman speaking to power. I should turn a little. I don't want to be the beginner, but I just want to start by saying how honored I am to be in the same room with Tania and to be able to share this evening with her. And we know each other for many years. But I was so concerned about her last year, and I'm sure all of you were. And although our situation and our life circumstances and political experiences have been very different, at the same time very similar, I can't think of anything more pertinent tonight but to begin by asking you to share some of your experiences for the past 8 months in Cuba. And the kind of traumatic experience you've had, I'm sure everybody, first and foremost, wants to hear that.
Well, I want to say the feeling is mutual, so I'm very happy to be here with you after so many years. And I'm very happy to see that maybe 90% of the audience are women. This is exciting. Women in power right here, right? Good. Good for you guys. Sorry for the voice. I think the most important part for me of the hard experience I went through, and it took me almost 4 months to talk about it, was the fact that I could finally prove to myself and maybe to my peers in Cuba that art has a role in social change. And the role sometimes is to speak things that people have not yet let's say, formalized. It's something they're feeling, but they haven't formalized it. But more than that, they can, art can be the place where people can go without fear and actually confronting power. It was very intense. The most intense part was when the head of the Arts Council decided to handle my case to the Minister of Interior. That was the moment that shifted everything. And this is the moment when my work started happening, actually. Because I always wanted to talk to power and talk to them in their face. And this is when the actual work started. I had to, the work changed a lot. Like, I came with one idea to Cuba, and then I had to adapt depending on what was happening. And for me, the most important part was to keep the ethics in the work. And the ethics meaning, you know, to be true to the work and to be true to what I think art should be doing. And one of the things I think art that is political work with is what I call political timing specific. So I think this piece could not be the same in another moment.
Can you explain the actual work that you did? I want to say maybe, those people don't see you. Can I ask you to move back a little? I'm very democratic. I want them to make sure they see you because they seem to be completely excluded. But could you, Tania, also explain to some of the people here who don't know exactly what you did?
Yeah, sorry.
That caused the problem. You know.
Well, basically, in 2009, I did a piece that where I did something very simple, which is I staged inside an art institution in Cuba what looks like some official Communist Party event with a podium, a big, beautiful, like this, drapes. And people were invited to be for 1 minute saying whatever they wanted. And it actually, surprisingly enough, it happened that people start talking. But sometimes there were moments of silence where for me were like almost monument to fear that were very strong. What happened is like after that, I was forbidden to exhibit in Cuba. I am an artist who never like to put emphasis in the censorship I get in my work because it's consequence of my work, so I have to assume it. I don't have to be whiny about it. And I know I'm, you know, it's an outcome of the work. So yeah, that was the resolution that I would not exhibit again in Cuba in any institution. And I went through a lot of stuff, like they didn't want to get me in one time with my students. Etc. But what happened is this time, in the 17th of December, the way in which Cuba sold to the world the opening the relation with the United States was that everybody was very happy, and that was not true. People were scared. They had no idea what was coming. The president, Raul Castro, never sat down and told people this is the idea of nation we want to build. They just say, this is a new situation, you have to assume it, and that's it. So I think my reaction was to write a letter to Raul, asking him very simple questions that apparently a lot of Cubans share, because in like, I don't know, in maybe a week and a half, we had more than 20,000 Cubans following the page I Also Demand, in Spanish, Yo También Exijo, on Facebook. So actually, this piece was not my idea. The piece was the idea of people who asked me to do the restaging of the microphone. So I had to do it because people asked me to do it, which I felt very honored. And I said, yeah, I'll do it. The difference is that before it was inside an art exhibition, now it was outside the protection of the art world. So it was actually in the place where politics happen. So I think that's, and it was Revolution Square in Cuba, and they, it's a sacred place. So you don't touch it. Only Fidel and Raul can speak there. And yeah. So the idea was very simple. It's like, how can you make a vertical decision horizontal? How can you make people being heard by power?
So did they stop the performance and make arrest, or how did it end?
Well, the thing is, like, they accused me. Well, first when I got inside, I don't know how much they tell you. When I got on the airplane, as soon as I arrived to the airport, I had a photographer waiting for me, taking photos of me. And I said, I don't give you permission for my photos. But he did, no, I'm not taking photos of you. So I hide next to a corner, and he came and keep. I'm like, then it's me, right? It's like, no, no, no. And then the next day, Twitter, they tweet and they put on Facebook this image of me at the airport saying, like, the drug dealer arrived safely to the country. So this is the beginning of the whole thing. So what they do, and I'm sure it happens in your country as well, what they do is they try to discredit you. They try to also make you do something you will feel embarrassed about, so they can use that embarrassment and shame to blackmail you and work for them or do whatever they want you to do. So I think that was the beginning. So I knew already this was going to be an intense ride. So, but I went to ask for permission. Everywhere I went, as soon as I say my name, they say, ah, yeah. I was like, okay, so they're expecting me. And then I spoke for 4 hours with the head of the Arts Council in Cuba. His only reason is not doing it. I'm like, no, I'm doing it. So that didn't go anywhere. I asked for a second meeting where I negotiated, and I have to be honest, I negotiated everything. Because at this point, it was 2 days before the event, I knew everything was exploding outside of Cuba, and I didn't want to be responsible for any violence or any problem. So I say yes to everything he asked me, until he say, and we know, as soon as we put it inside the museum, we're going to let enter whoever we want, because we have the right to let people enter. Derecho a admisión, Spanish. And then I say no. I say, what are the parameters that you're going to use for that? Are you going to have photos of people? Like, who, well, the dissident, counter-revolution, like all this, you know, thing again. And I say no. Like, all my life I fought against censorship. I'm not going to become the censor of my own work. And that's it. And I say, let me think about it as a way to get out of the four-hour meeting. And then he called me, and I say, no, I'm not doing it there. Like, you, I'm not going to accept that. So then the day of, 4 a.m, they cut all the phones, cell phones, landlines, and there were more than 20 people surrounding the building. And I felt like Osama bin Laden,
building?
Where my mom lives.
Your house.
Like, my mother was amazing. The only thing she had, talking about women in power, talking to power.
So they came to your house. Actually.
They came to the house. They didn't have any paper, anything. So they work in a very illegal way. But because they count that you're afraid of them, and you will do whatever they ask you because you're afraid, that's what they're counting on. So I made them wait 7.5 hours, which made them later accuse me of not collaborating with the police when they were trying to accuse me of stuff. And the only reason I opened the door, because also they didn't show me anything, like paper, nothing. Like, they were just, abre la puerta! You know, it was like super intense. And I say, you know what? I have to open now because it's 2 hours before the event, and I knew there was something wrong was going to happen. I'm like, And then I say, am I under arrest? They say no. And I say, well, I go with you with two conditions. Do not, handcuff me because I'm not prisoner, right? They say, no, we only need to talk. Talk here. No, let's talk in the office. I'm like, oh, whatever. And then the other condition is like my mom can talk to my sister, who was amazing. My sister was the person behind the reason you all know about this. And she can cancel the event. Because I was very afraid of a tragedy. Of course, they never let my mother do anything. And as soon as I got to the police station, they say, enter and change. And they put me prisoner.
So you were a prisoner.
Yeah. So that was it. Very easy for them.
But then this continued on for months and months. And you were taken back for interrogation several times.
Well, yeah, I have to say that I have to thank the more than 2,000 people in less than 24 hours signed the letter. And it's interesting because we always do things on Facebook, and we always criticize Facebook because we think it has no effect. In my case, it did have an effect. the fact that you guys signed that letter in less than 24 hours showed the police, and the, not the police, but the Ministry of Interior, that people cared and they were going to look bad. They still had me 8 more months, but I mean, it was harder. Even then I went like 4 more times to prison, but they always took me out.
But did you throughout the whole time felt that the local community, the cultural community was concerned about you and
that's
fighting
you want
for
to
you?
Answer that question?
I was just, because I have the, yeah.
Well, well, the thing is, this piece is part of what I call arte de conducta, or behavior art. So for me, what makes the meaning of the work is the way in which people behave. So the fact that, for example, some local artists, because the biennial was so close and they needed to be in the official list of the government in order to have the collectors go to their house, decided to avoid me, is great. It was painful, but it's perfect for the work, because that behavior gave the meaning of the work and reflect what's the state of Cuba now. Like, money is the new god.
Were you ever terrified of ending up in a dungeon in a prison in Cuba? Because very often I have a choice of returning to Iran or not, mm-hmm. and whether I take that risk of entering, and many people say, oh, you should never go, even my own family. And sometimes I think, oh, I should just go for it. Maybe nothing would happen. But there's always this one moment where I think, do I really fancy the idea of ending up in this horrible, you know, I mean, you just imagine the worst scenario. But in your case, when they came to your house, I mean, were you just simply terrified of the being, I think, being incarcerated, it's losing your freedom. It's, I've only experienced it once, which I'll talk about, but how did it feel for you, that moment where they came for you?
I want to answer, but then I want to hear why you, what the relationship you have with Iran is. So, I think I discover that injustice has a physical manifestation. Like, when you feel injustice, like what you hear, it is true. Like, when injustice is done to you, it has a physical body manifestation. It's a feeling, it's not just an idea. And that was something I discovered. I also discover a lot of feelings. I don't know how to call them yet, but that was great. So it, the only time I was afraid, and fear was not exactly what I felt. It was like different things. Like, for example, one moment that was very intense was the night before the event. I was thinking, everybody told me like they will not let you go in. And I'm like, what can I do? So I say, oh, maybe I'll be like a homeless person walking all night around, you know, Havana, so they cannot find me. Of course, that was very silly because by then I was already being followed. But, and then I decide, no, because I'm not doing anything wrong and I cannot have the mentality of a criminal. That's what they want, that you think that you're right is a crime. And so that was one moment that was pretty intense. But the only moment I was afraid, I was really, really afraid, was when I was in the house and I couldn't communicate with absolutely anybody to stop the event. Because I was afraid. And people who were there says like, secret police was dressed as civilians, waiting something to happen to start punching people. Dissidents were there, journalists were there, and artists were there. So I think that was the moment.
Well, I've never had anything as traumatic as your experience. I think one thing we have in common for sure is being born in the axis of evil, Cuba and Iran, automatically comes with a lot of baggage. So it's not like I think either one of us chose to be political. In fact, I think I'm the most apolitical person as you could be, but just being born as an Iranian and born during the time that we experienced the Islamic Revolution that pretty much determined the fate of myself and all my family, it is a direct influence in my life circumstances. So that's obviously inseparable from my life. But I don't usually like to talk about these things in public, and I have to say I agree tonight because Stephen did, partially because I think it's extremely private, and part of it is for security reasons, I must confess. And like her, I have family in Iran. I mean, I'm not like the most wanted person, but it's in general, we live with this paranoia and fear, and much has been written about us, and we all dream about returning home. And I think the biggest difference between me and you is that I've chosen not to go back, and you choose to go back, and you are going back. And I wanted to bring out just a couple of important points is that you have to understand that my generation of Iranians was exactly the generation that brought the Islamic Revolution, or the revolution that later was called Islamic. Many of my friends who are sitting here were very active during the revolution, and I wasn't. But I do remember, as someone who was in my small town in high school, that the country was really moving against the Shah. Radically, there was a huge resistance of students and the clergy against the Shah, but also Khomeini was becoming very popular, and this whole move toward Islamization and the idea of Islam as sort of offering a sort of a most authentic ideology became very popular. And my best friend in high school was very much working underground. And I remember going home after school, and she would rush to the radio and listen to the speech of Khomeini that was being broadcasted from Iraq, which he was living in exile at the time because the Shah had sent him on exile. Apparently his son was executed, etc. So every day I watch my best friend and, you know, his sister, her sisters, going and listening to this radio, and my father quickly sent myself and my sisters abroad. Eventually, the same friends became very active in the Mujahideen, which is the militant Islamic movement. And in fact, my friend got killed, and they had to leave the country, and then eventually they got killed. And not to be dramatic, in fact, many of my friends that I work with today have spent years in prison, and some of them are in this room. And so their experiences has been far more traumatic, where I came to California and had my sunny days. And but the next point I want to make is, after the diplomatic relationship between Iran and US broke down, the wall came down between Iran and US, and I was no longer able to travel to Iran because also the war with Iraq was happening. So there was a period of about 11 years that I didn't see my family. And so I, while they were suffering throughout this whole turmoil, the revolution, the aftermath, the transformation of the country and the extreme oppressive situation and people being executed right and left, I was in California, studying, although I was psychologically devastated. I think it was the hardest years of my life. And eventually when I went back, which was when I moved to New York in 1990s, I came to the US in 1975, and I didn't go back. I went a couple of times, and after the revolution, I didn't go back until 1990. So it was a very long time. I was so taken back by the changes of the country and my own friends, some of them who had left, some of them had died, some of them who really could tell me a little bit more about, you know, the groundwork of the revolution, everything that I had missed, what had happened, why the country was in the state that it was. And I started to work the Woman of Allah, which was really my, I had no profession, I mean artistic career, but it was an extremely personal curiosity. And I want to use the word personalized because I think both of us, the artwork is extremely personal. And really was for me this immense curiosity to understand the generation that brought the revolution. What was the foundation, the ideological, the philosophical basis of the revolution? And me just being a sort of an outsider, almost like a sociologist. And slowly I started to be like a researcher, talking to people, interviewing, collecting books. And then one thing led to the other. I made the Woman of Allah series when I came back. Eventually I became very suspicious for people. The government found it's problematic that I was making this work. They thought I was criticizing the system, the Islamic Republic of Iran. And the people who were against the government found it problematic because they thought that I was actually endorsing them. The one moment that I had a very traumatic experience, I remember, as I was going back and forth to Iran, my son was about 4 or 5 years old. And for those of you who, maybe Cuba is like this, when you're coming out of Iran, it's like going through 7 gates. And my family left, and I went through one after another. I had just actually shot some photographs. I had the contact sheets and my son in my arms. And I got stopped. And basically, the horrible-looking man, again, this is nothing comparing to people who were nearly executed in prison. But for me, it was my first time facing authority, talking about people of power. And at once, I was faced with this man who had no logic of any kind and immediately told me that I was in deep trouble, that I was going to be taken to the court, and I knew exactly what, and I kept saying, but I don't understand. I'm an artist, I haven't done anything. And he said, you know exactly what you have done and you're not going anywhere. I was like, I was here last year and I was defending, and he just told me to shut up and be quiet. And while my son was sleeping, it was very frightening. And meanwhile, the plane was about to leave. My family had left. And it was a terrifying 2 hour of sitting in front of this man, feeling absolutely helpless. He took my passport, and I wouldn't allow him. And this is nothing, again, comparing to what you have done for 8 months. But for a moment there, I realized that loss of freedom and the fact that I was completely helpless in the arm of these people. I don't know what happened. He went through these drawers. Eventually, I made a video out of this that sort of was a reminiscence of this experience. Then he just simply brought my passport and threw it at my face and said, just leave. And meanwhile, I've seen all these people getting on the plane and they were just ignoring me. And I was like, look, I'm not guilty. I haven't done anything. But they were acting like I was some criminal. And all I did was come inside the airplane and throw away my veil and cursing everybody in that plane. And then when I entered the United States, I remember passing my passport to an African-American immigration officer, and he said, welcome home. And I started to cry. I never went back to Iran after that. And the government is, you know, whatever. There's been a lot of discussions about my safety, but the next time, and I want to be short because I want to come back to you, the next dramatic thing that happened was in 2009 when the Green Movement happened. Being a person that always felt that the political material was embedded in my work, but I was not comfortable being an activist. Suddenly in 2009, as most of you know, it was immediately after the election that there was a huge uprising in Iran, and I'm sure all of you know, suddenly every Iranian inside and outside became mobilized, inspired, provoked by these young people who were literally risking their lives for a call for democracy, not overthrowing the government, but a call for democracy. And for the first time in my life, I became an activist. All of us in New York, you know, when I traveled as well, we started to participate in protest. We wore green in Venice when I showed my film. I organized with some people a hunger strike in front of the United Nations. I started to collect petitions for prisoners who were wrongly arrested and raped and all kinds of atrocities. And I felt very proud. I felt extremely proud and extremely mobilized. And there was something as if it was dormant that had awakened in all of us, where we felt this incredible sense of unity. And it was euphoric, and that led to the Arab Spring. Without going too long, I have then, since then, become less of an activist, but I have yet found a new situation where I found involuntarily a sort of a voice where I'm asked often to speak on behalf of the people, sometimes of Iranians. And I was asked to speak at the World Economic Forum, which maybe we can share later. to address the heads of the states and NGOs for the first year that the Iranian president was attending the World Economic Forum. It was extremely difficult for me to think about how to address a crowd that knew nothing about art, nothing about me. And the next day, the president was addressing. So I tried to prepare a speech that for 3 minutes appealed to the people to see the political crisis from the eyes of an artist. And I used the Iranian example as how throughout the revolution, before and after, while the people were suffering inside and the doors was closed to us, what became the saving grace of our culture was the Iranian culture, Iranian artists, writers, theater directors, filmmakers that truly made fantastic work regardless of censorship, lack of freedom of expression, lack of resources, and became really fantastically flourishing into the world. And so I said to the president, now that you're here, we artists have done our job, we hand you the torch, it is your time for being that saving grace. And that somehow worked, and I want to come back to you because the message somehow that we as artists, and I believe Iranian society again, Cuba as well, is the greatest example of how artists, despite freedom of expression, have made some groundworking pieces of creative work that have spoken both to their own people and to the world at large. And I take great responsibility as an artist beyond and above the art world. And I think this is sometimes difficult to penetrate and talk through in New York, where art becomes heavily a commodity. And I want to, because I'm immensely curious and I haven't seen you for a long time. And I must say that when you were in Cuba, and I guess Ai Weiwei in China is another example, but he became a superstar. But the point of not being a superstar, but remaining really humble to your people and to the absolute cause that you believe in, and yet making critical work of art that is not reduced to something of lesser degree. And I want you to speak about that. How do you, as an artist, operate in a way that you keep faith with your responsibility to your people and what you're fighting for in your culture, and yet make work that speaks to these people and to the international art?
Well, before that, I saw a lot of things that were very similar, and I want to share a few things. One is when I came to the United States after this 8 months of being in Cuba, I was also welcomed by an African-American agent who actually asked me, why have you been away for so long? Because I have
a
green card.
Here.
You're supposed to not be more than 6 months, something like that. So, and I say, well, I had a situation in Cuba because political reason, the government took withhold my passport. And then he, which is something that happens a lot, and it's one of the biggest difficulty my work has when it comes to Cuba, is that people have a very specific political imaginary about Cuba. And it's very hard to challenge that. So he was like, you should know better. And I was in tears. I was very sensitive about that. I was like, I cannot believe you're telling me this. Like, I confronted him. And I really lost my mind and was like telling him like, this is wrong in Cuba. I was talking like, I cannot believe, like, because you guys did your civic revolution. I want to do my civic revolution. Like, what all this is. And then the guy's like, okay, put the stamp on it.
Take it.
And then I left in tears because it was so intense for me, like not having solidarity because my cause is not something that was seen as a worthy cause. Freedom of expression in Cuba is not worthy for many of the people, especially the left. And as soon as I left, I was like, oh, this is what I want in Cuba, that I can tell the guy who has in his hand the chance to put me in prison or return me to my country, talk to him what I think, and we disagree, and then that doesn't mean that he's withdrawing my rights because I disagree with him. So I think that was a very intense emotional moment. that. And the other thing is, I think in Cuba it works very differently than other countries, because one of the things that this piece did was, first of all, mobilizing more than 20,000 people who are Cubans who decided to leave the country and not to engage in politics anymore because they were sick of it. And because of this piece, they came back to this discussion. The other thing that it did is it put the dissidents and the opposition as the center and front of the piece, together with artists, with normal citizens. And that's the one line you never cross in Cuba as an artist. Like, you can do art talking about Che Guevara, like, of course, you never criticize Fidel and Raul. But anything else that is kind of phenomenological, like, oh, like something you want to complain about through your work, is fine. Asking for the causes of the malfunction of society, ban. Talking about the responsible of the malfunction of the society, banned. But also talking to dissidents or opposition. Artists know that's the one line they cannot cross. And that was the one I crossed as well. So I think it's interesting, because then immediately all of the other artists dismiss your work because you talk to the dissidents. Whether in other countries it's normal, if you're an activist, you're talking to the people who dissent with the government. So I think that's a very specific characteristic of art that is political in Cuba. Therefore, I think if you don't talk to these people who are activists, it's very hard to for really that your work is really political in this case. So I think that's something that is also very different for the case you were talking. And the last part that was really maybe different from your experience, but similar, is like the biggest challenge I had was to control my story. Because they were taping me all the time. Like, when they took me out of my house, there was a guy in the camera in my face like this. And I was like, what are you using this for? They never answered me. As soon as I was dressed as a prisoner, they were taping me. I was being taped all the time. Sometimes I knew, sometimes I didn't know. Like, I was talking one time with my brother in the street, and then this guy came and said, hey guys, they're filming you, this guy there. And then we saw this woman with this other guy with the camera. And then we went there, and they were like running, and you know, it was like really crazy. Like, and the thing is, like, I until today, maybe this is the biggest fear, maybe not fear, but doubt. It's like, what stories are they going to make about me? They even tried to use the fact that I had a very complicated relationship with my father, who was part of the government, and they actually brought me the day of his birthday to the cemetery in front of his tomb, which I have never done, because once people die, I give him life, knowing death. So so they brought me to the tomb of my father, and they wanted to manipulate me because they brought this like marble piece saying his name, date of birth, date of death, a revolutionary and a father. And they were filming, because there was, this is in the middle of the day, in the work day. The cemetery was empty the whole way. And then there is this couple who is sitting on a tomb of another person. Nobody sits on the tomb of a person as a couple. Like, I mean, but they, these people didn't look that way. So, and then you have this car with tinted glasses that is exactly in the perfect place where they can shoot at you. Like, and then I enter the door, the car, and they're like, yeah, it's intense, right? Like, they thought, finally they did something to me, right? Oh, it's intense, you cannot handle it, huh? I'm like, whatever, let's go. And then when we left, I'm like, why are you filming me? Why? So this is the biggest thing. Like, how are they going to change the story? And of course, they have all the resources. So for example, this is something that, and I think we should do more of this in the art world. We should use the art world and not them, obviously. For example, one of the things they started spreading, the rumor, is that I decided to leave art. that I was not an artist anymore, and what I was doing, it was not performance, it was not art. And the reason I participated in the Venice Biennial was not so much that I care at that point about anything art-related in the art world or career or any shit like that. It was because that was my way to demonstrate that the Venice Biennial, one of the biggest events in the world, in the art world, chose me as an artist. So therefore, their argument is wrong. So I think this is the kind of things that...
But also, I mean, you have a U.S. passport or resident?
No, I never wanted to be a U.S. citizen. I have been asked many times. And the only reason I don't want to be an American... Well, I have many reasons, but one of the reasons I don't want to be an American citizen is because I always, and I tattoo here, people who know me, they know, I tattoo here my address in Cuba because I know I was going to come back at some point. Yeah. When Fidel got sick, I say I know I have to do something for the future of this country as a citizen and as an artist, and I knew I was coming back, and I knew I didn't want to give an easy way out to the government. The fact that they had to take my passport, the only passport I had. And I tell you, the first 5 sessions of interrogations were about my status. It was crazy. This is like 3-hour interrogation.
But do you think that if you had become naturalized citizen of US, they would have protected you and that would have made more of a pressure on the Cuban government to harass you less?
Or? I don't think so. I think they will be like, take your American person and get out of here. And I think part of my work is, as an artist and as a performance, is to see where the space of friction is, enter that space of friction, and try to show people what is behind the spectacle. And in this case, I think I'm very, very proud that the piece shown to all of you and to thousands of people who believe that country is an amazing, beautiful, utopic country, that social justice doesn't exist there anymore, that, and they show the mechanism of power towards citizens. And this is me, somebody who had all of you to defend me. Imagine people who have nobody. And that's why I was very emphasizing that every time everybody talked about what happened to me, it was not me, it was the issue. And I was very clear that it was not, oh, Tania, poor Tania. No, I don't care about poor Tania. It's like freedom of expression. That was very clear in all my correspondence with my sister and the people who were supporting. It's like, talk about lack of freedom of expression. That's all I want.
You know? But Tania, I hear that you're going back, like, soon.
Yes, I'm going the 21st of December.
I have to say, a part of me worries about you.
No.
I mean, what
But I'll tell you why I'm coming back. I'm coming back because, and I have to be honest, I think one thing as a person I enjoy, although enjoy is a very twisted word in this context, was the fact that everything was so clear. Like I could see like a game, you know, like what they do in this. And I was very, very, very clear that I had to do things not because I wanted to, because I was looking at what the consequences of my actions were and who will benefit, the government or the people. So I think that was the... But the other thing is like, and I have to confess here, like by the last month, my brain was smushy-wooshy thing that I could not use anymore. I couldn't see anymore. I couldn't think anymore. They really, I mean, these are people who come twice a week to your house to talk for hours and hours and hours and hours and brainwash you and try to question everything you say and why you're doing and trying to make you think you're not the person you are. This is after 20 interrogation sessions with the instructor. This is like after they realized that way they were not getting anything, so they were like the good cops now, right? And that was pretty intense. And I was very nervous to make a mistake because then you can't see anymore. You don't know what you're doing. And then I said, well, I'm leaving. And I was very stubborn because they gave me the passport 6 months into it because that's the legal timeline they have to retain somebody without anything. And then I asked, I need a letter who shows that my case is closed, because I had a case, and that I can come back to Cuba. And they didn't want to give me that for a month and a half. Seeing them twice a week for 3-4 hours every time. So that was pretty intense, but that's the letter I'm handing in my hand. I know it doesn't matter, because they told me the day they gave me a letter, like, you know, if we want, you don't enter ever this place again, right? I'm like, that's okay, give me the paper. And then the day I left, when I was really relaxed, I went to the airport. And the reason I didn't make a big fuss about it is, like, first, I really, believe it or not, I don't like all this attention. And the other thing is, I had a person very close to me that I think was snitching on me, and I needed to make sure. And that was the only person, not even my sister. Nobody knew I was leaving, only that person. And of course, as soon as I get to the airport, Javier and Andrea, the two guys who come to my house twice a week to talk to me, arrive. And say, they told us you were here. And give us your telephone number so we can contact you, because we're going to United States. I fucking freaked out. I was like, you know, enter my safe space, you know, like. And I was like, no, I have no phone because of you. I haven't paid my phone in 8 months. I lost my number. And it's like, give me your address. So I said, well, I have no apartment because I didn't pay the rent, so I have no apartment. And so I think it's very interesting. Also, maybe it happened, I don't know if it happened in Iran, the fact that these people who are running a country, who have no experience outside of the country, have also a crazy idea what outside of the world, the outside world is. And they're running a country with an assumption that's completely wrong about what's happening in the world.
I think Iran is the same.
Yeah, right?
I mean, it's interesting because, again, I chose a life in exile as opposed to going back. And this whole notion of insecurity, like, I mean, let's talk about this last 2 weeks. I mean, ever since what happened in California, the shooting, this whole, well, let's go back to Paris, you know, the whole Islamophobia and Donald Trump's, you know. I mean, the last time I...
Let's not lower the level of the conversation.
Yeah, no. I'm afraid Trump has a lot in common with some of the people in Iran. But what I remember right after September 11th, I felt this incredible sense of racism that I never felt in this country. But then it went by, you know, quickly, just the way we looked and whatever. And it's a very intense time. And then just the last few months, it's come back again. Where this, since ISIS and this whole anxiety of the violence now coming into Europe, into America, and now again this media like publicizing in such magnitude, even Donald Trump's statements, and so this whole anxiety coming back to me, and I'm really talking on personal level, because I usually don't get worried so much about racism or this feeling, because I say, well, I don't go back to Iran, but this is my country. But for the very first time, I mean, this last few days, us in my studio, my immediate community and family, we're talking about, oh my God, they're asking us as Muslims to start wearing something here that says we are, you're going back to the Nazi time. Is it possible that we need a visa to go now with American passport, that we can be separated as Jews once were? Where are we aiming at this society? What is happening? This is more backwards than Iran is. I mean, it's really that sense of insecurity. And so I think part of the choice I made, like, my family are still in Iran and we try to meet here and there, but we all agree that it's safer not to, for me to go back. But I realize that this notion of insecurity and anxiety, it remains with you constantly. If I go to Europe, I always, more than anywhere, I feel like an outsider. In this country, I normally didn't. Now I'm really worried. I want, again, we're talking very frankly tonight, things that I don't normally like to talk about. But you know, we're talking about our countries and the governments that are really demonic. But now...
It's interesting one thing. And now, because Cuba, U.S. having this opening relationship, not opening relationship, but like getting, you know, reestablishing the relationship. One thing is happening, also there exists censorship from the side of the Americans, of the U.S. government and the U.S. people, because, and I give you a very small example, like a friend of mine recently did a show in D.C., he's from Cuba, and somebody approached him and say, like, it's better if you don't do so critical work. Like, this is an American official person, like somebody who works in the government. It's like, it's better if you don't, right now it's not good to be too critical to the Cuban government. And this is now a double censorship, because how are we going to make sure that in the transition, human rights are going to be respected if even the people who are supposed to defend that are telling artists, slow it down a little bit. So I think that's one side. The other thing is that, that's one thing I want to say, just like this double censorship in a way. Not that everybody's saying that, but some people are like, moderate is the good thing now.
But you still didn't answer my question about the art world. And how we, as again, there's so many areas to cover in this night, and I was thinking of it. But we are two women artists in this male-dominated Western, from Cuba and Iran. And we have our own people to serve and also an international. So how do you kind of navigate in this, you know, East and West or the local, the global, like, situation?
I think it's a very good question. One thing is that I think very global, in a global way. I'm working with immigration issues, which are not very specific of anywhere because it's happening everywhere. But I think our generation, maybe younger people are, like, free of that feeling, but I think our generation is able to think globally, but it still feels locally. It still feel nationally. And as an artist, I feel like now I have to, you know, shift my projects between the immigration and the Cuba. But I don't know. I don't know if I understand your question much, but
I'm talking about art form, art in America. I'm talking about David Zwiner, Barbara Gaston, Chelsea.
Not
I'm talking about how
I'm
do
not
you.
With that.
No. I'm making a. I'm talking about you have, in my case, in your case, you have the government of Cuba and Iran in your back, and then you have the New York Times critic on your back. I'm talking about this this.
Well,
I just want you to think about the arc. Is you're in one side expected to make art in the highest, you know, level that is free and timeless, and et cetera. And at the same time, you're morally, psychologically, emotionally, politically invested in something. It's so important. And yet you're truly an artist, and you don't want to be ghettoized at the same time. So there is this triangle.
There is a very good world outside of the art world.
That's what I was hoping you talk about.
You know, and the art world is not the only world we can live in. I have this love-hate relationship with the art world. So I like it when it's one or two people at a time. When it's more, I get... But, I think, for example, I'll give you an example. One of the artists who actually is very wealthy in Cuba, who doesn't need the government because he's really, really free. He lives even in Spain, and... when this happened, the day I was in prison, one of the other artists say to that person who was having a party with a lot of art world, international art world creators and
the biennials
before, just for New Year's Eve, because New Year's Eve, not advertising this, but New Year's Eve in Cuba is becoming a thing. So all these curators, international people were there, and you know, and this artist said, Tania is in prison right now. And he say, I don't want my party to be disturbed.
I think I know who
so
that
I think, is. I'm not telling names. But I think I was, and one of the biggest thing, hardest thing is not to change who I am in this process. Like, remember who I am all the time and not letting that go to me. But I was very surprised. And then I realized that a few months later, when the biennial happened in May, he had an agreement with the government that the first international gallery opening in Cuba was his gallery. And that gave him a lot of leverage and also free space to make his huge studio and his huge event. And you know what I mean? So there were negotiations behind, and they were negotiating with ethics. That's what they do now. So you give me your soul and I give you. So I think, thank God, I don't need to deal with that. I don't get all the money he has. I don't get all the funny times he has, but I feel better.
I have to say one thing I respect a lot about you. It's when the news came about Tania's being harassed, arrested, etc. It was an explosion all over the newspapers. I remember.
I didn't know that. You know, it was very weird.
Yeah, which is a good thing. Yeah. But what happened was, you kept, even when you came out. I mean, I don't want to use the example, but I think we often turn people who suffer politically into celebrities, and Ai Weiwei is a great example, whom I like, is a friend. But in Iran, we have certain filmmakers that have been in prison for like a month, and then suddenly they say, oh, they somehow is used in sort of self-promotional way. And I have a friend who's sitting right here, he always says, I wish every time I went to Iran, they would arrest me and put me in prison. So this way I become famous. Because somehow in Iranian community, you know, we have someone named Panahi who says he's forbidden to leave the country, forbidden to write a script, but he makes a film every year. He's the biggest box office. He wins every prize in the world because he was in prison for 2 years.
He had that in Cuba too.
So, I mean, so there is that kind of corruption of artists who use incarceration and you know, governmental harassment as a way to self-promote themselves. And I find that extremely problematic. And maybe they do it unconsciously. Maybe they don't even do it. Maybe the attention is so large. But what I want to say
to you... But there is a market for that too.
For sure. I mean, I think the prices of artists go up. And
that's the trap that I'm trying not to get into.
And I wanted to say that, so you're going back to you, I understand when you came back, you chose to go to New Haven to live quietly and away from the center and to make your work and to recollect yourself. And I really respect you for that. And the fact that you want to go back, despite the fact that it could be risky.
They cannot win. That's the thing. They cannot win. They cannot think they made me afraid, because they didn't. And because I think they need to learn the lesson.
Bravo to you. I don't know, how are we doing with the time? The last little thing I wanted to make, going back to this business about how do we as artists navigate between our...
Can I say one thing? Sorry. Yeah. The only reason I'm talking about this is because she's forcing me.
Yeah.
Because I don't even want to talk about it, because I think the work happened, the performance existed, it went really well, so I don't need to, you know... So, yeah.
Tonight is extremely intimate, because I have to say some of these things we talk about, I never talk about, but I talk about it because you're here. But in going back about artists who feel compelled to delve into sociopolitical issues and feel like outside of the art world, I've gone to the film world. And I feel this tremendous freedom, because with cinema, it's not exactly, I mean, if you are in Hollywood, I think, of course, it's a very commodity-driven venture. But I feel with filmmaking that it gives me a very healthy distance, but also that you can address very important historical, political issues through a fiction that you could never do for a gallery and museum. So that's been one way for me to sort of keep that little distance.
Well, I did it with the activism, so... Yeah, so this is. And actually, the other thing is, one of my response to all of this really intense nonsense of putting me, because one of the other reasons is like, as soon as I got out of the first detention, I had a list of more than 50 people who were detained because of the work because they were there to participate. So it's ironic that I always say in my statements that I want to liberate the audience. In this case, I had to literally liberate the audience from prison. So I think I talk to this guy and say, we need to take this, you need to liberate my audience. This is one thing, I always talk to them as an artist. You know, like, this is my audience and you have the audience in prison, so liberate the audience. So I think in this case, it was very interesting that actually they put me in prison for asking that. And I say, I'm not leaving until everybody's liberated. And they came to me, they're like, well, there are 24 more people. I'm like, no, I say everybody. And then, can I please go back to my prison? And so they were very mad at me. Because every time I said this, like, you think you're going, ah, they were screaming at me like, oh, we don't exigencia, we don't. So, and then I said, fine. And then again, no, now we have like 12 people. I'm like, I said, everybody. And then I was able, as an artist, to take the audience out of prison in less than 24 hours. And this is nothing, because this, the only thing I did is my responsibility as a political artist. You know, this is what you have to do when you are doing political art. Be responsible of what people, like the consequence of your work, and deal with that as part of the work. So I think, at the same time, I recognize that things can change in Cuba because a stupid person can do that. You know, imagine if more people join. So I think that was very, very good.
I think it's time for Stephen to come to ask his fresh questions.
And I'm sorry if I've not been very articulate, but still for me it's a very emotional moment, so.
So I'm just gonna ask one question, and then we'll have again people on either side. Just raise your hand to ask your questions, and I'm gonna sit to the side. So considering that the U.S. has opened its policies in some ways toward both Cuba and Iran, I'm just curious about what you think that means for you and how that's going to affect you. For example, you know, for a long time, and Shirin has alluded to this, she hasn't gone back, and I'm curious if some sort of thaw might change the way that you think about your future as an artist in relationship to your country and going back. And you, of course, are going back, and you didn't really talk about the institute that you're going to start. Is there a reason for that? Can you talk about that at all? Okay, so really that's what I'd love for you guys to address.
So I think in Cuba also we have a consequence for opening for the art, the relationship, and I think the consequence is the market, which is extremely good for the government, because a lot of artists, there are a lot of very good artists in Cuba, but some artists have decided to join the market. And why this is good for the government? Because these people are becoming not middle class, but high class. Therefore, they are more distanced from the people. Therefore, the work is more driven by the market and for the foreigners and not talking to the locals. And also it is a way to control them, right? So I think we're going to see a lot of Cuban art, some of them good, some of them bad, some of them complacent to whatever you want to see, because they want to please you. But I wish people see beyond that and want to see what really happens in Cuba and demand that from the artists. So yeah, and the other thing is, as a response to everything that happened, I did a performance in my house where I was reading the origins of totalitarianism over and over and over and discussing it with people. And
Hannah Arendt's text.
Sorry, Hannah Arendt's text. And two things were very interesting. When I came up with this idea, and then people say like, oh, do you know that in Venice they're reading the Marx, The Capital? And I say, okay, And this is great because when you do this kind of art that is not to please the art world but to respond to very specific political situation, you are liberated from all this constraint, like oh, it has to be something new, it has to be something original. No, because you use whatever is the best tool to talk to policy and to talk to politicians and to talk to people there. So in this case, I was like, I don't care they're doing that. I'm not competing for like who's the most like novel idea. I'm competing with my government about you need to understand this. So I think that was interesting debate in my head at some point. And of course the government in Cuba is extremely creative, so as I put some speakers, and as soon as I did that, they came with hammers, street hammers, and they only opened the space in front of my house. They were so silly. And I even told them, don't do that. Like, this is the biennial, there's going to be a lot of press. It's like, well, it's an order. I'm like, I tell you, it's better, you're going to look really bad. So I even did that. And they didn't take that in consideration. So I think that's pretty interesting. And also it was interesting that when they were having lunch, I read the section about people working for the government as a spies. So, and they were listening. Those people who were opening the street. So I think what I want to do after everything, I think what happens in Cuba is a lack of civic education, education about your rights and education about... So what I want to do is an institute called the Hannah Arendt Institute for Art and Activism. And it's going to be a think tank for policy and constitutional change. It's going to be a workshop driven, where we do workshops and then we go to the street to show everybody else what we have learned in a performative way, hopefully, and a residency. It's not going to be one of your cute residencies. It's going to be a residency where you deal with politics and as an artist and have a research assistant from the place. And hopefully it's not all about Cuba. It also will have an aspect where we bring international issues, but they have to be related with what happened in Cuba. They have to resonate with the process that we're going through.
When will that start?
It already started when I started reading Hannah Arendt. It already started when I went to Costa Rica to see the more than 4,000 Cubans who are in the border between Costa Rica and Nicaragua, just because Raul told Nicaragua to close the border. That's it. He needed to negotiate with the United States, so he didn't care about 4,000 Cubans. He has started. It's not going to be, it's going to be in my house in Havana, but it also will have this kind of very performative appearances in different situations. So it's going to be a very unstable form as well as a formal form.
Well, I think you're going to have some applicants from this audience.
They're all welcome.
So Shirin, I'm curious about the changing relationships, obviously, between the U.S. and Iran. What does that mean for your work and what you're thinking about?
Well, I think the changes are more a projection of, you know, the impact it will have on the outsiders going to Iran. Mostly it was done for economic reasons, the lift of the embargo, which was really important. I know for a fact that there was a medical shortage and people who were really suffering not having certain medicines, and I'm so glad that has been lifted. But the truth is that the Iranian government, it economically needs the world to come to it. So in some ways they project this image that Iran is becoming more moderate. But I have a friend from Germany who went with the whole German entourage, and it felt like East Germany, like the whole time they were being watched. The issue about this government, it's very unpredictable. There are many different layers of governments, military, secret, whatever. All these Iranian people know who they are. And so you don't really quite understand. It's not like I'm at quite great risk or I'm that kind of importance for the government. But I have lost interest in the country in that way. And it's really hard for me to say that, because for many years, every time somebody said, I'm going to Iran, my heart would just ache because I wanted to go back to see where my family and where I came from. But something happened in these years, and I became very, like, enraged of this, and I'm almost like angry, but this government is stupid. But in general, I've lost that nostalgia in that way. And I started to expand to the Arab world, and I'm spending a lot of time in Egypt, in Morocco, in a lot of areas that somehow living in this way of being off center, off home, it's become very comfortable. And I'd like to go back to visit, but I don't even know. I feel like a part of me doesn't want to go back. And it's very hard for me to say that. But I feel like uprooted in a very way that I'm really hurt in a way that I don't think it's a matter of just saying, oh yeah, come, and then I go and everything is going to be okay. I don't think everything is going to be okay for me. I know in Iran things are really exciting. There's a great culture. People come and say, I would never leave Iran. It's like the most exciting time. You're missing it. You're missing all the great period of great creative time, and you know, it's true. I've lost it. And I'm older and whatever. But I've invented this other reality that it's being in between cultures, and I'm very comfortable with that. And I don't know if I can be a place where I'm born and I speak the same language as everyone. I look like everybody else. I don't even know what it's like anymore. So for me, it's really more of a personal and emotional, but started from political, because I didn't have the choice from the time the revolution happened. And this is what goes back to the beginning of what I was trying to say, is the whole thing's become very personal. It goes deep, and at some point you don't know who to hate anymore, who to blame. But this feeling of disjointment is not what she has, because she goes back.
I know who to blame.
You know how to blame.
And also, I wish I was in your state. And I now, since we are on New Year's Eve, I really want Santa to give me not to care about Cuba anymore, because it's very painful.
So thanks to the two of you for the conversation. And let's turn to the audience now. So questions. Someone, Yovana, back that way. Okay, here, okay, and then there.
Go ahead. Hello.
Hello?
Oh, yes.
First here, and then you'll be next.
Okay. Sorry. Thank you both for being so honest and open tonight. And I had a question I was wondering if you could each address in respect to when you're making your work, and it's about, just get up. And it's about your relationship to spectacle. Like if it's something that you outright reject, or if it's something that you feel like you can control and perhaps use and turn upside down. And how does it function both while you're conceiving the work, during the work, and perhaps afterwards? Because I think it can have different roles.
So is the question spectacle in relationship to the making of their art and what their art is, or?
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Well, in my case, I feel, I've said that I use the tools of power to do my work. And one of the tools of power is a spectacle. And I have used it in my work. I have used it but a spectacle is a very angry monster, and you need to be careful that you can control it, because it can go out of your hands. And as same way I say spectacle, I talk about theatricality, because that's part of what also a spectacle is, a distancing of the experience, right? So I think in this case I use it. I use it sometimes. Sometimes it comes and you have to deal with it. Sometimes I have to stage it. So in the case of Cuba, to be honest, it came. So I had to actually control it, because I didn't want to go out of hands or out of subject. But yeah, I use it. I use it, and I think we should use it. in a conscious way. Not for the sake of the spectacularity, but because it's a tool to bring people in a certain behavioral mode that you want to work with. Yeah.
I mean, if I understood your question correctly, I think it's in the nature of many Iranian artists to think very subversively and use poetic, allegorical, non-spectacle style work, because very often we face censorship and everything has to be told very candidly between the lines. So the Iranian people have become a master of saying one thing but meaning another. And I think, especially for political messages, etc. And we are a country known for poets and mystics, and you know, Iranians are very comfortable with that kind of allegorical approach that has to have something to do with dictatorship. So I feel like in my work, I also approach everything, including violence, atrocities, oppression, and politics in general, in the most allegorical way. Because I think not only it's indirect, it allows it to have a level of universality in its resonance. So it's a more of a quieter, it's not so loud, it's more sort of a quieter scream, if I could say it like that, yeah.
Also, I want to add something. In countries like ours, where the public sphere is very controlled, where reality is being dictated and being narrated only one way, when you do art that is hyper-realistic, in the sense that it really touches reality and want to be part of reality, that immediately becomes spectacular, whether you want it or not. Because that is an area that you are transgressing because it doesn't belong to you. It belongs to power. So, yeah.
So the question there.
Hello. First of all, thank you so much for being willing to go to these intimate spaces with us tonight. I noticed that you both recounted stories of interactions with male authority figures, and there's a lot of discussion, especially recently, the connection between masculinity or men and abuse of power. And I'm curious if you've ever had that oppositional interaction with female authority figures and your thoughts and feelings about that.
My interrogator was a female. Actually, when the first time I got detained, they put me a guy. Then they brought another guy who was evidently a therapist, like a psychologist. Because the first thing is like, oh, I'm so honored to meet you. I study so much arte de conducta, behavioral art, and I'm interested in behavioral. So I'm like, okay, this is the therapist that they put me here, the psychologist to mess with me. And then I decided not to talk to him, and he was really out of his comfort zone, whatever. And I think they got that I might not have talked to male interrogator. It wasn't I didn't have any bias on that. So it was a female interrogator with a lot of masculine energy, which was kind of appealing and sexy. So yes, I went to therapy here to talk about the Stockholm Syndrome. Yes, I did.
On that note.
I'm really opening now here.
It is getting intimate tonight.
So I had that, but also not only female male, but I had this very intense situation where I had Javier, who is the guy who came to my house. I had Kenya, who is the interrogator, and I had Andrea, who is a younger mulata. We say in Cuba, I don't know how you say it here, but younger, like she was maybe out of school, like, you know, training school or whatever. So she was by the book very much. And Kenya said in a very despective way many racist, horrible thing about this woman. Very racist. La negra de mierda, bueno, all these things. And then I look at Javier and say, like, you know, is this allowed? Like, this is very, and this is the other thing, you try always, when you have the situation, to make sure there is a situation where respect is not lost, even if you're under interrogation, like, you have to respect me, I cannot accept that from you. And then this other girl, who is an African Cuban, you might say in American terms, and she's like, no, I'm not offended. I was like, sorry, but, you know, so I think it's not only male, female, it's also race, it's also status, and it's also knowledge. And the knowledge part I won, because I had more knowledge about the world than they did. And I think what I try to do is to, and that was, they were really intense. They were really intense. But at one point, what I tried to do, first of all, I say, I'm not going to accept any lies. So we're going to talk the truth here, which is something they don't do. And secondly, what I did at some point is start, you know, saying, I'm not going to lie, but also I'm going to tell you everything I think about you. And I'm not going to accept any disrespect. I mean, I'm interrogated, okay, but you don't need to disrespect me because I'm treating you with respect as an interrogator. So I think these kind of dynamics were very interesting. And I think at some point I kind of changed the dynamic a little bit. Not that I think I did a good job or anything. I'm sure they did a lot of psychological shit in my head. But it became this thing where I start talking to them how ridiculous what they're doing was, because the world was looking at that and they were not looking good. So I think it was interesting that the knowledge helped to change the dynamic. So I think it's not only male, in my case, not only male, female. Although I have to say that Javier, who will probably listen to this at some point, said, I wish I had known you 10 years ago. You will be so different. And I'm like, really? Okay. He doesn't know some part of my life, probably. So I think this has this kind of sexualization and like domination through that at some point. But yeah, it was not the case in my case.
Shirin, do you have something to add?
No stories.
Okay.
Come on.
No, I was going to say something about eventually. I'll tell you later. No, go. Let's go to the next question.
Next question. There and then here. Wait for the microphone, please.
You had the microphone? You can pass it on the front.
Hi. First, thank you. Okay. And I want to start by saying I'm also an Iranian American. And one feeling that I have, which I think my father passed down to me, is this feeling about being an imposter, being neither going for what the current state of Iran is, it's only a dream for my family or an image for me, I've never been there, while also being in America, a place that was torn apart by America in the 54 coup. And how do you negate that tension? And does that come out in your art?
Well, I don't know if you have seen my film, Woman Without Men, that was entirely based on the coup that took place in 1953. I suggest you see that because the film was based on a novel that just remotely hinted as the background of the story that the film, the story took place during the 1953 coup. But I found that immensely interesting that the Americans were completely unaware, majority of Americans, of their intervention in Iranian politics and how, in fact, the 1953 coup was the groundwork for the Islamic Revolution, etc. And it was also an opportunity for us to recreate Iran before the modern Iran in the 1950s. So we, together with Shoja Azari and Shahram Karimi, who's here, the production designer, we created, we went through a lot of extent to recreate Iran in Morocco of the 1950s and created the scenes of the coup that we looked extensively at the archival footage of BBC. And so I felt selfishly, and I wanted just, because you spoke as an Iranian, and I think history is become very interesting for me. And in every work that I did, it seems like Woman of Allah speaks about the Islamic Revolution. Woman Without Men was about 1953 coup. The Book of Kings was about the Green Movement. So somehow, subconsciously, I've become sort of a narrator of Iranian history, but all done in a very mythological and allegorical way. But 1953 coup, in fact, was one that I spent a lot of time together with our colleagues researching and making it into a film. I think it's the only film that has been done that has, in a fictional way, addressed that period. And then when we started to tour with the film, we talked extensively with the American public about, you know, that they were so, I'm sorry to say, ignorant about the fact that, you know, this was one of the dirtiest things that the Americans have ever done. So just wanted to point out that has been taken care of.
Next. Okay, so one there, and then you will be next.
Good night, Shirin and Tania. Thank you so much for being here. I have two questions, but I don't want to be rude and hoard time, so I'll just ask one.
Believe me.
This question is for Tania. First of all, I'm very sorry that you had to endure the cruelty of the prison complex. In that note, I have a question on a very human level, not intended to be a political question. I'm very familiar with the case of the Cuban Five, and I wanted to ask you, how do you felt as a fellow political prisoner in a human level about their situation, being them the opposite of you, right? And them being supported by the government, it's something very complex for me that I'm very curious about, because I'm sure you have very conflicted feelings about it.
Yeah. Well, everybody is familiar with the, okay. So the Cuban Five, as it's called by the government, or the spies, as it's called by the American government, were people who were who came to the United States, and some of them, I think they shot this airplane who killed other Cubans in Miami, and they were spies, and they were the FBI took them into they knew about this group of people, and they took them in prison, and for I don't know 15 years maybe. Cuban government has spent millions and millions and millions and millions of dollars in the lawyers, in propaganda, in like trips to other places to defend these people and bring them back to Cuba. Finally, with the U.S.-Cuba arrangement, they were traded by a U.S. aid person, or and also another spy the Americans had in Cuba and something like that. So yeah, so I think I have never ever felt related to those people, but it's interesting your question, because I think the one thing that is related is the fact that the Cuban government can only imagine that people criticizing them have to work with a foreign government, and that's extremely offensive. And most of the time I was in Cuba, I had to defend the fact that I was not a CIA agent, that I was not working for another government, that I was just an artist and a Cuban citizen who had the right to criticize the government. So I think that's the only way I can relate it to that, the fact that the Cuban government, because they actually do that. They actually plant these people in other places. They actually do terrorist act in other places. They actually have a lot of people in Miami and other places in the United States full of spies waiting for orders. They think everybody else is doing the same to them. And in my case, I was just an artist using my rights. So that's the only way I can relate to that, which is not, yeah.
Hi, also thank you so much for being so genuine to a group of strangers. I guess my question was, in the midst of all your political and personal experiences, how do you choose what to frame in your work and in your process? Or rather, how do you distill your experience, or how do you choose what to prioritize in the midst of so much that's important?
It's an excellent question, because you know, I think for me, oftentimes existential questions are as crucial as political ones, but sometimes they melt into one another. And but I think when I look back at my work, whether film or photographic or video, I see a pattern of themes that seem to repeat themselves. And the obsession, I think, often comes in this dilemma that I feel as a human being, that if I could be as corny as saying my own inner world and who I am on the inside and the world that I inhabit. And I always very conflicted as a person. And I see myself in so many different ways, and I can't quite make sense of it. I see myself as an Iranian, as a Westerner, as an extremely fragile, insecure, weak person. I see myself extremely strong and together and confident. I see the world as purely horror, and then I look at a lot of beauty. I see everything in the form of contradiction. As being a woman, I feel so empowered, and yet, you know, opposite, I feel repressed very oftentimes. So I think at the end, every work that I make is really framing a particular question that seems so critical for me at a point of my life that somehow seems to be shared by other people. I mean, just to give you an example, at the moment, I've been working on a film about the Egyptian singer Om Kulsum, who is dead now since 1975. And she was an iconic artist who was not a traditional woman, and was not, was very masculine actually, and she never really, you know, was married or anything like that. But she reached the highest level of popularity, and it's immense curiosity for me looking at other women artists, such as the novelist of Women Without Men and other poets, looking at other women and how they have coped with their creative imagination, their public responsibility and public persona, and you know, just practical things. So I feel always conflicted as an artist, as an Iranian, as a woman. And so these show themselves within characters and narratives that somehow later I realized they were just mirroring my own, if I could say that, and yeah.
Can you repeat the question? I can hear you.
Oh, you can hear me. I guess in the midst of everything,
how do you choose your subjects?
Okay. So I think in my case, it doesn't happen the same way always. Like, what is related to what you just said is that it is always very personal. Like, I don't have this big agenda like democracy in the world, people happy forever. No, it's more about things that I cannot understand, because the solution is so easy and I don't get why people cannot fix it, or things I don't understand. Basically, it's trying to understand things. And I also don't talk for absolutely anybody else. What happened is, like, when I say what I'm thinking, I guess other people relate to it, but I don't want to be the person talking for a mass or for somebody else. I think everybody has the duty to speak for themselves. So I think in this case, it is mostly things I don't understand, or think that, you know, yeah. And sometime before I start working, a phrase become very clear, or a gesture that brings the meaning is very clear. Sometime is a feeling that I have to work through the piece, as it happened in this last piece. So I had to work through it and make sure I don't lose direction. So sometimes I know where I want to get. I don't know how I'm getting there, too. That's why also my form is less stable. That's also why I'm very open formally until the last minute. You know, I'm very, very open, which make a lot of people crazy when they work with me. But I'm like, no. We need, why? Because the work is being informed by so many outside elements that I have to deal with, that I cannot come just with my point of view sometimes.
We have time for two more questions. Are there any questions? This is a very shy side of the room. Or,
oh, there you go.
Oh, there we go. So let's.
So, you see? To activate.
Me first?
Thank you guys for sharing. I have a question, and it's a matter of ethics. And as a filmmaker, or as an activist, an artist, how do you deal with those situations where it's kind of, it's not black and white, and you feel like if you don't completely share something in a certain way that you're doing an injustice, or if you do, that you're doing an injustice? That's my question for both of you ladies. Thank you.
Actually, I think it's an excellent question. I've always felt that the way that I've approached issues that are political, sociopolitical, religious issues is simply frame a question. I've never been, I hope I have never provided answers. But I think the critical thing for me is those questions that I choose to frame, and that becomes my sort of statement. And I think that's, it's extremely dangerous when, as you know, as you can guess, when you come close to all these issues that are so, you know, and so for me, it's always been about that, is find issues that I think are important, are critical, and just make a work, whether it's a photograph or a film, that somehow explores around those issues, and that's it. But keep it so open for interpretation, where people can draw their own conclusion, what is right and what is wrong, who is good, who is bad. And this is really tedious, because we are against certain type of authorities, et cetera, but it would be so didactic to make a piece that it's just pointing fingers. So it's really a challenge to make work that it's not obvious and not didactic in our case, yeah.
Well, in my case, I think what I try to do is to create a safe environment so people can be themselves, and to create a situation where we have shared responsibility.
So we'll take one more question, and then if you'd like, you can come up and barrage them personally at the stage.
Thank you.
Oh, there we go.
One. Hello?
Okay, we'll do two. So, one here.
Thank you guys for sharing your stories. They're very touching. So, my question is for Tania. I watched the piece that was in Cuba. And
You were in Cuba?
No, I watched it. Oh. I was just thinking, like, you know, going into the whole staging, you must have had some frame of reference, or maybe just some things that you first saw happening, you know, when you opened that mic up to the public. My question is, what was the biggest surprise going back of the people that came up there? Because there were so many different reactions, and a lot of it was very angry and directly at the government. Some people were just like crying, and just there was so much there. What if anything was a surprising factor for you out of all the reactions?
I didn't see any of that outside. You mean the people outside or the people inside of Cuba? Inside, okay. So I think what surprised me the most is the fact that the Cuban government never understood that I wanted the best for my country. And I was not the enemy. That I was not trying to do anything wrong. And I even told them every step on the way, don't do this, it looks bad. And they couldn't go away from the enemy situation. At some point they negotiated, but So that was very surprising to me, the fact that Cuba had a discourse for the outside world that has not been cashed up by the response the government has for the situation that is going to come with that thing they tell in the world they want to be. So I think this kind of like, this juncture between how repression is being used versus the new Cuba they want to sell to the world, that was really surprising, that they didn't cash up rapidly enough, which of course make people see that it was not true. So I think that was the biggest accomplishment, understanding. So the thing is that it was for me very surprising the levels of censorship even foreigner artists in the biennial had to endure. There were these artists who, after her performance, and again, I never asked anybody to do anything. Everybody was doing whatever they wanted. But after her performance, she screamed, "Free Tania." And she had a horrible time after that. And she was a foreigner. So this is the level. And also I learned that the Havana Biennial met with the artists, Cuban artists in the Biennial before the opening, like 2 days before, and told them, "Is anybody ask about Tania? Say you don't know." So I think this surprised me, not because what they did or what they wanted to happen, but the fact that they were so reckless and so like openly doing these stupid things. You know, do they think I was never going to find out? You know, and all this very, yeah, I think that surprised me how unsophisticated they were, and the fact that the solution for everything was infantilizing the situation. Like one day I went with Las Damas de Blanco and then they brought me like this to my mom and it's like, "She's behaving bad." Like I was a kid and I'm like, "I'm a woman, so treat me as a woman." You know, so I think this idea of infantilizing everything as a way to take away the power of what you're trying to do. So that surprised me.
Last question on this side.
Thank you. I have a comparative question about the respective authoritarian regimes. And I was struck, Tania, when you said that you could demand respect from your interrogator. And I wonder because all these regimes exist on a continuum of brutality or oppression. So within the context of Iran, could you say to your interrogator, Shirin, perhaps, "You need to have a little more respect for me"? Or is that continuum, is Iran located much further along on that continuum of brutality? And then where do you, both of you, see these regimes developing as relationships increase with the West? Is there going to be greater repression? Will there be opportunities for soliciting respect from your interrogators, or will it become more challenging?
I can't tell you how many books I've read as memoirs by my friends who have been in prison. I haven't obviously been in prison myself, but I have many, and I have friends who have been, and we talk endlessly about this. The woman who wrote Woman Without Men, she was in prison for 5 years. She's one of my best friends, and she's wrote a most beautiful memoir about her prison memoir. And she tried to humanize some of these people who work in prison system in Iran. And I've read so many other, because I knew them personally. Some of them have been made into films. I know one woman who seduced her interrogator and made him fall in love with her just to get out. It's hard to see anything other than the fact that I really believe the interrogators in Iran really believe what they're doing is actually a good thing. I mean, I think there are a group of people in Iran that absolutely believe in this regime. and absolutely believe that what they're doing is the right thing. So it's not just the government, it's actually people who are fanatics, religious, who are totally against certain ways of thinking. And so the Green Movement, for example, was a great example how some of the most innocent, beautiful young people died for no reason, absolutely no reason, because it was actually their right to be protesting on the street. And they were raped and executed. I mean, this is really atrocity and this hardest. So I won't give them any credit of any form of humanity. And I think the best I could say is maybe they're so deeply brainwashed and that they just can't think of any other way. But yeah, I don't think they would have ever given respect. I don't know.
Well, I wish in Cuba people believe. I think people do not believe in the system anymore. I think there is a concept that we have, which is called jinetero. The jinetero is a prostitute. That the difference with the prostitute, yeah, she takes money, she takes goods, but the difference, like, she make the person she's hustling believe she's in love with them. That's what the government is doing. And that's what people are playing with, you know, this kind of emotional. That's why I think art is so important in Cuba right now, because it's all about manipulating emotions. And so this is one thing. The other thing is that, this is my sequela there. I lost a lot of memory in this process, but what I was going to say.
What was the question again?
Well, the thing is that interrogators respect. The thing is that you have to. Do I have to answer that question?
Maybe you don't have to answer.
Maybe I don't have to answer a question, but you know, it's still. I think it's. The thing is, I get as much as I could give you tonight. I'm so sorry. And I'm sorry that sometimes I make jokes. It's the way I can talk about it. Sorry about that. So
thank you to you both. Thanks for your work and thanks for your courage. Thank you for coming tonight.